Good day to everyone. So I will be discussing about the psychological theories. This psychological theories is one of the three theories of criminal behavior. Okay. So there are many different psychological models of criminal behavior, ranging from Freudian notions to later cognitive and social psychological models. So in these psychological theories, there are questions that the criminal justice is very concerned, and also with the criminologists who are attempting to answer these questions. So why do individuals commit crimes, and at the same time, why is crime present in our society? So in actuality, the questions of why crime is committed is very difficult to answer. So however, for centuries, people have been searching for answers. It is important to recognize that these are many different explanations as to why individuals commit crimes. So one of the main explanation is based on psychological theories, which focus on the association among intelligence, personality, learning, and criminal behavior. Thus, in any discussion concerning crime causation, one must contemplate psychological theories. So first, I will discuss to you the psychodynamic theories. So under this psychodynamic theory is the jointness. When we say jointness, it is defined as a dynamic process representing an emotional for attachment and for communication between separate individuals who jointly approach each others. So in the jointness, it represents an encounter between the mother and the infant, the psychotherapist and the patient, or any partners experiencing simultaneously mutual intimacy, while concomitantly safeguarding separateness. So under this psychodynamic theory is the psychotherapy. So when we say psychotherapy, it is the use of psychological methods, particularly when based on regular personal interaction, to help a person change and overcome problems in desired ways. So the aim of psychotherapy is to improve the individual's well-being and mental health, to resolve or mitigate troublesome behaviors, belief, compulsion, thoughts, or emotions, and to improve the relationships and social skills. So certain psychotherapies are considered evidence-based for treating some diagnosed mental disorders. So there are over 1,000 different psychotherapy techniques, some being minor variations, while other are based on different conception of psychology. So one of the technique in this psychotherapy is the one-to-one sessions between the client and the therapist. In this psychotherapy, psychotherapists may be mental health professionals such as the psychiatrists, psychologists, and clinical social workers, and also with the marriage and the family therapists or professional counselors. So they may also come from a variety of other backgrounds, and depending on the jurisdiction, may be legally regulated, voluntarily regulated, or unregulated. And the term itself may be protected or not. So in general, psychodynamics is the study of the interrelationship of various parts of the mind, personality, and psyche as they relate to mental emotional or motivational forces, especially at the unconscious level. In the psychodynamics, there are mental forces involved. Okay? And it is often divided into two parts. One part of this mental forces is the interaction of the emotional and motivational forces that affect behavior and mental state, especially on a subconscious level. And the other one is the inner forces affecting behavior, the study of the emotional and motivational forces that affect behavior and state of mind. So this is the psychodynamic theory. Another one is the behavioral theory. When we say behavioral theory, this is the second major psychological theory. Okay, this is the what we call behaviorism. This theory maintains that human behavior is developed through learning experience. So yung pagkakaroon yung mga behavior natin ay na-develop daw through learning experience. So the hallmark of behavioral theory is the notion that people alter or change their behavior according to the reactions these behaviors elicit in other people. So in an ideal situation, behavior is supported by rewards and extinguished by negative reactions or punishment. There are behaviorist views. Okay, the behaviorist view crimes as learned responses to life situations. So in the social learning theory, which is a branch of behavior theory, it is the most relevant to criminology, yung social learning theory. And one of the prominent social learning theories is Albert Bandura. Okay. According to Bandura, individuals are not born with an innate ability to act violently. And also Bandura suggested that in contrast, violence and aggressions are learned through a process of a behavior modeling. So also Bandura said that in other words, children learn violence through observation to others. Okay, yung mga bata natututunan nila yung mga iba't ibang klase ng behavior through observation. So, the aggressive acts are modeled after three primary sources. What are these three primary sources of aggressive acts? One of the family interaction, environmental experience, and the mass media. When we say family interaction, there are some researches that demonstrate that children who are aggressive are more likely to have been brought up by parents or caretakers who are aggressive. Okay. Another one is the environmental experiences. This is the second source of behavioral problems. So in the environmental experiences suggest that individuals who are reside in that areas that are crime prone or more likely to display aggressive behavior than those who reside in low crime areas, one could argue that high crime areas are without norms, rules, and customs, sila yung mas agresibo. But furthermore, there is an absence of conventional behavior. The manifestation of the unconventional behavior includes the inability to gain employment, drug abuse or alcohol abuse, and the failure to obey social, local, state, and the federal laws or laws in the society. So most important, individuals who adhere conventional behavior are invested in society and committed to a goal or belief system. Okay. So the third sources of behavioral problems is the mass media. So it is difficult to discern to the ultimate role of the media in regard to crime. So there are some scholars that have suggested that films, video games, and television shows that depict violence are harmful to children. Okay. So ultimately, social learning theories beckon us to accept the fact that the mass media are responsible for a great deal of violence in our society. They hypothesize that children who play violent games and later inflict physical or psychological damage to someone at school did so because of the influence of the video game. So malaki yung influence ng mass media to the behavioral problems of a children. Okay. So another one is the cognitive theory. When we say cognitive theory, the third major psychological theory, okay, in recent years, significant gains that have been made in explaining criminal behavior within the cognitive theory framework. So here, psychologists focus on the mental processes of individuals in this cognitive theory. More important, cognitive theories attempt to understand how criminal offenders perceive and mentally represent the world around them. So, germane to cognitive theory is how individuals solve problems. So, there are two prominent pioneering in 19th century when we talk on the cognitive theory. These psychologists are Wilhelm Wundt and William James. So in this cognitive theory, there are two subdisciplines. So one is the moral development branch and the information processing. So when we say moral development branch, the focus of which is understanding how people morally represent and reason about the world, okay? And this the second subdiscipline is the information processing. Okay, some in this processing, it is focused on the way people acquire, retain, and retrieve information. So ultimately, the scholars are concerned with the process of these three stages, the acquire, retain, and retrieve information. So this is the acquisition, the retention, and the retrieval. Okay. So one theory within the cognitive framework focuses on the moral and intellectual development. So si Jean Piaget. Okay, so Jean Piaget hypothesized that individual reasoning process in develop in an orderly fashion. Okay, thus, from birth onward, an individual will continue to develop. Okay. So another pioneer of cognitive theory is Lawrence Kohlberg, who applied the concept of moral development to criminological theory. So Lawrence Kohlberg believed that individuals pass through stages of moral development. Okay, so most important to the theory of Lawrence Kohlberg is the notion that there are levels or stages and the social orientation. So another one is the personality and the crime. So when we say personality, this can be defined as something that make us what we are and also that which makes us different from others. So ideally, personality is stable over time. So examinations of the relationship between the personality and crime has often yielded inconsistent results. So one of the most known theories of personality used to examine this relationship is the Big Five model of personality. So the Big Five model of personality provides a vigorous structure into which more personality characteristics can be categorized. This model suggests that five domains account for individual differences in personality. So what are these differences in personality? One is the neuroticism, the extraversion, openness, agreeableness, consensus, and consensuousness. When we say neuroticism, it involves the emotional stability. So in neuroticism, individuals who score high on this domain often demonstrate anger, sadness, and have irrational ideas, uncontrollable impulses, and anxiety. But in contrast, person who score low on neuroticism are often described by others as even-tempered, calm, and relaxed. So another one is the extraversion, the second domain of this Big Five model of personality. It is characterized by sociability, excitement, and stimulation. So individuals who score high on extraversion or the persons who are extrovert are often very active, talkative, and assertive. But they are also more optimistic toward the future. But in contrast, is the introverts. Okay, introverts are often characterized by being reserved, independent, and shy. So another one is the openness, the third domain of this Big Five model of personality, referring to individuals who have an active imagination. Find not only active imagination, find pleasure in beauty, are attentive and to their inner feelings, and have preference for variety, and are intellectually curious. So individuals who score high on openness are willing to entertain unique or novel ideas, maintain unconventional values, and experience positive and negative emotions. More than so that individuals who are close-minded. So in contrast, persons who score low in openness often prefer the familiar. They behave in conventional manners and have conservative viewpoint. So the fourth domain is the agreeableness. This domain is related to interpersonal tendencies. So individuals who score high in this domain is considered warm, altruistic, soft-hearted, forgiving, sympathetic, and trusting. But in contrast, those who are not agreeable are described hard-hearted, intolerant, impatient, and argumentative. And the last domain, the fifth domain, is the consensuousness. Focuses on a person's ability to control impulses and exercise self-control. Okay. Individuals who score high in this domain are described as organized, thorough, efficient, determined and strong-willed individuals. In addition, those who are conscientious are more likely to achieve high academic and occupational desires. But in contrast, people who score low on this domain are thought to be careless, lazy, and more likely assigns fault to others than to accept blames themselves. So this is the relationship between personality and crime. Another one is the psychopathic personality. What is psychopathic personality? So antisocial personality, the psychopathy and sociopath is the terms used interchangeably. Okay? When we say sociopaths are often a product of destructive home environment. Okay? While psychopaths, these are the product of a defect or aberration within themselves. And the antisocial personality is characterized by low levels of guilt, superficial charm, above average intelligence, persistent violation of the rights of others, incapacity to form enduring relationship, impulsivity, risk-taking, egocentrism, manipulativeness, forcefulness and cold-hearted, and shallow emotion. So the origin may include the origin of this psychopathic personality may include the traumatic socialization, neurological disorder, and brain abnormality. So interestingly, if an individual suffers from low levels of arousal as measured by neurological examination, he or she may engage in thrill-seeking or high-risk behavior. So what are these high-risk behavior? Such as crime to offset their low arousal level. Other dynamics that may contribute to psychopathic personality is apparent with pathologic tendencies. Okay, childhood traumatic events, or inconsistent discipline. So pag meron yung mga ito, magkakaroon tayo ng tinatawag na psychopathic personality. That's the but it is important to note that many chronic offenders are sociopaths. Okay? So thus, if personality traits can predict crime and violence, then one could assume that the root cause of crime is found in the forces that influence human development at an early stage of life. So this is the relationship between psychopathic personality and crime. Okay. Another one is the intelligence and crime. So the relationship between the intelligence and crime. So criminologists have suggested for centuries that there exists a link between the intelligence and the crime. Some common belief are that criminals and delinquents possess low intelligence, yung mababa yung kanilang intelligence, and that this low intelligence causes criminality. Okay. As criminological research has advanced, scholars have continued to suggest that the holy grail is the causality. Okay? When we say causality, it is the ability to predict criminals from non-criminals. Okay? That is the ultimate goal. So the ideology of IQ and crime has crystallized into the what we call the nature versus nurture debate. So the nature versus nurture debate is a psychological argument that is related to whether the environment or heredity impacts the psychological development of individuals. So sciences recognize that we share our parents' DNA. Kasi ipapasa naman sa atin yung tinatawag nating deoxyribonucleic acid ng ating mga magulang. Okay. So just like yung mga mata natin, yung mga itsura natin, kung minsan nakukuha natin yung iba sa ating mga magulang. So, in the nature of the nature versus nurture debate addresses this issue. What are this issue with respect to the nature side? Okay. So, research on the population or prison population has continuously shown that inmates typically score low in IQ tests. So, ano ba yung nature ng nasa kulungan? So, ang sabi nila, yung mga nakakulong, they have the low IQ. Okay? So, but on the side of the nurture, okay? So, when we say nurture, jury, it advocates the ground themselves on the premise that intelligence is not inherited. Ang sabi ng nurture theory, intelligence is not inherited. So, there is some recognition of this role of heredity. Okay? However, emphasis is placed on the role of the society. For example, okay, the parents are a major influence of their children's behavior. Ang mga magulang, malaki yung influensya sa kanilang mga anak. Okay? So, habang bata kasi, yung magulang, tinuturuan yung kanilang mga anak. For example, is reading books, playing music, and engage their children in art, museums, and sporting events. So, if some parents spend no quality time with their children, and these children believe to perform poorly on intelligence tests. So, kapag kulang yung quality time ng parents, mayroong low IQ yung kanilang mga anak. Okay. So, the nature versus nurture debate as I will continue. Okay. This debate has peak and valleys for years. The debate subsides and this is followed by years of scrutiny and great deal of attention. So one of the major study that highlighted the nature versus nurture debate was conducted by Travis Hershey and Michael Hindelang. So this scholar suggested that low IQ increases the likelihood of criminal behavior through its effect in school performance. Okay, so this argument seems somewhat elementary. So their argument is that a child with low IQ will perform poorly in school. Okay, in turn, this school failure is followed by dropping out. Okay, so the second nature versus nurture study that warrants attention was conducted by Richard Dornstein and Charles Murray. In their book, The Bell Curve, this scholar suggested individuals with a lower IQ are more likely to commit crime, get caught, and sent to prison. So these are the two major study in relation to intelligence and crime. As we talk about the nature versus nurture debate. Another one is the Freudian psychoanalytic theory. Okay. So the proponent or the founder of this psychodynamic approach is no other than Sigmund Freud. Okay. Considered as the father of the psychodynamic approach to psychology. Okay. The role of the mind is something that Freud repeatedly talked about because he believed that mind is responsible for both conscious and unconscious decisions based on drives and forces. So the unconscious desires motivate people to act accordingly. So there are, according to Freud, there are three personality traits of a person. This is the id, ego, and super ego. This is the three aspects of human mind. Okay. Another one is the psychoanalytic theory. Okay, this theory was also originated by Sigmund Freud, the founder of psychoanalysis. So these are the three elements of human personality, the id, the ego, and the super ego. So the proponents of psychodynamic theory suggest that criminal offenders are frustrated and aggravated. So they are constantly drawn to past events that occurred in their early childhood. Because of negligent, unhappy, and miserable childhood, which is most often characterized by lack of love and or nurturing, a criminal offender has a weak or absent ego. These theories will be further discussed in your theories of crime and causation. So when we say id, this is the pleasure principle. The id as the primitive part of a person's mental makeup, and it is present at birth. Okay. So Freud believed that id represent the unconscious biological drives for food, sex, and other necessities over the life span. Okay. According to Freud, the id is a part of the unconscious that seek pleasure. Kaya tinatawag na pleasure principle. Kasi pagbata tayo, kung ano yung gusto natin, ay mapapasa atin. That is the id. Okay. So, in this id, it is the impulsive or the unconscious part of the mind that is based on the desire to seek immediate satisfaction. Okay. The id does not have a grasp of any form of reality or consequence. So it is the id is compared to the horse. Okay. It is directed and controlled by the ego or the rider. So the other one is the ego or the reality principle. Okay, when we say reality principle, in order for people to maintain a realistic sense here on the earth, the ego is responsible for creating balance between the pleasure and pain. Okay? Because it is impossible for all desires of the id to be met, and the ego realizes this but continues to seek pleasure and satisfaction. Although the ego does not know the difference between the right and wrong, it is aware that not all drives can be met at a given time. So the reality principle is what the ego operates by in order to help satisfy the id's demands, as well as compromising according to reality. So the ego is a person's self composed of unconscious desire. Okay. And also the ego has the function of self-preservation, which is why has the ability to control the instinctual demands from the id. Okay. For example, is when children learn that their wishes cannot be gratified instantaneously, they often throw tantrum. So Freud suggested that ego compensate for the demands of the id by guiding the individual's action or behavior to keep him or her within the boundaries of the society. And the ego is guided by the reality principle. Okay. Kung minsan yung mga bata kapag hindi na ibigay yung kanilang gusto, yan nagmamaktol na. Okay. Kaya andyan yung tinatawag nating ego. Okay. So next is the superego, which the what we call the conscience of man. Okay, which develop this superego which develops around the 4 or 5 okay, around age 4 or 5 that incorporates the morals of society. So according to Freud, believe that the superego is what allows the mind to control its impulses that are looked down upon morally. So the superego can be considered to be the conscience of the mind because it has the ability to distinguish between the reality as well as what is right or wrong. So without the superego, Sigmund Freud believed people would act out with aggression or other immoral behavior because the mind would have no way of understanding the difference between the right and wrong. Okay. So, in sum, the psychodynamic theory suggests that criminal offenders are prostrated and aggravated. They are constantly drawn to past events and that occurred in their early childhood because of a negligent, unhappy, miserable childhood, which is most often characterized by lack of love or nurturing. A criminal offender as a weak or absent of ego. Okay. So there are defense mechanism to anxiety. So the anxiety and defense mechanism. So what are the three types of anxiety? We have the reality anxiety, neurotic, and the moral anxiety. So Sigmund Freud proposed a set of defense mechanism, okay, in one's body. This set of defense mechanism occur so one can hold a favorable or a preferred view of themselves. Okay. So in the three types of anxiety, when we say reality anxiety, this is the most basic form of anxiety and is based on the ego. It is typically based on the fear of real and responsible events. For example, being bit by a dog or falling off the roof. Okay, that is the reality anxiety. While the neurotic anxiety comes from the unconscious fear that the basic impulses of the id will take control of the person, leading to eventual punishment from expressing the id's desire. Okay, while the moral anxiety comes from the superego, it appears in the form of fear violating values or moral codes and appears as feeling like guilt or shame. Okay, so when anxiety occurs, the mind's first response is to seek rational ways of escaping the situation by increasing problem solving efforts, and the range of defense mechanism may be triggered. So these are the ways that the ego develops to help deal with id and the super ego. So what are these defense mechanism created by Sigmund Freud? So one is denial. When we say denial, this is believing that what is true is the actually false. Okay? Believing that what is true is actually false. This is denial. Another one is displacement. Okay, the taking out or the taking out of impulses on a less threatening target. Okay. Another defense mechanism is the intellectualization or the avoiding unacceptable emotions by focusing on the intellectual aspects. Okay. Another one is the projection. When we say projection, it is the attributing uncomfortable feelings to others. Okay. Rationalization or the creating false but believable justification. Okay. Reaction formation, the taking the or the taking the opposite belief because the true belief causes anxiety. That is the reaction formation. The other one is the regression or the going back to a previous stage of development. Okay. And the repression is the pushing uncomfortable thoughts. Okay, pushing uncomfortable thoughts out of conscious awareness. And the suppression, okay, the consciously forcing unwanted thoughts out of our awareness. And the last one is the sublimation, the redirecting wrong urges into socially acceptable actions. So these defenses are not under our conscious control, and our unconscious will use one or more to protect oneself from a stressful situation. They are natural and normal, and without this defense mechanism, neurosis develops such anxiety states, phobias, obsession, or hysteria. So we need this defense mechanism. Another one is the low IQ theory. When we say low IQ theory, once the IQ crime correlation is measured, the next is to explain it. Okay. So the explanation of the IQ crime correlation typically take one of three approaches. So what are these approaches in explaining the IQ crime correlation? First is the IQ and crime are spuriously not causally correlated. Okay, not causally correlated. Number two is the low IQ increases criminal behavior. Then the other one is criminal behavior decreases IQ. So in this group, okay, there is a popular argument against IQ as a cause of crime, criticizes IQ test as only measuring middle class knowledge and values rather than innate intelligence. As a result of the observation that some minority groups and the poor score low on IQ tests simply reflects their diverse cultural background. So the same groups also commit proportionately more crime because they suffer structural disadvantages. What are these structural disadvantages? Okay, it includes poverty and discrimination. Consequently, the same people who score low in IQ tests also tend to commit more crime. And so IQ and crime are empirically correlated. Thus, this correlation is not causal, but reflects only culturally biased testing on intelligence. Okay. So there are explanations that links IQ to crime. Okay. And, for example, is the school performance. Less intelligent students do less well in school, which result in academic frustration. Okay. So this frustration, in turn, weaken their attachment and commitment to schooling, and a weakened bond to school, as per social control theory, allows for more criminal behavior. So this school performance hypothesis has received strong support from empirical studies, and it is probably most widely accepted explanation of the IQ crime correlation. Okay. So another one explanation about the correlation of low IQ, okay, low IQ theory, okay, is the argument against IQ holds that even if people commit crime with equal frequency, less intelligent people would be less able to evade detection and would be arrested more often. Yung mga mabababa ang IQ, sila yung laging naaresto or yung hindi nila nalulustan yung kanilang nagawang krimen because of that low IQ. Okay. So next is the ADHD or the attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. When we say ADHD, it is a mental disorder of the neurodevelopmental type. So this ADHD is characterized by problem paying attention, excessive activity or difficulty controlling behavior, which is not age. So the symptoms appear before a person is 12 years old. So may makikita mo yung symptom of ADHD when a person reaches 12 years of age and are present for more than 6 months and cause problems in at least 2 settings, such as the school home or recreational activity. So this is the what we call the ADHD. So in children, problems paying attention may result in poor performance, although it causes impairment, particularly in modern society. Many children with ADHD have a good attention span for tasks they find interesting. Okay. So another one is the frustration aggression theory. The frustration aggression theory, otherwise known as the frustration aggression displacement theory. This theory of aggression is proposed by John Dollard, Neil E. Miller, and others. So in 1939 and further developed by Miller in 1941 and Leonard Berkowitz in 1969. So this theory says that aggression is the result of blocking or frustrating a person's effort to attain a goal. So in this frustration aggression theory, frustration may be defined as the state sets in if a goal-oriented act is delayed or thwarted. It is the feeling of irritation, annoyance when something blocks you from achieving your goals, okay, from the word frustration. Okay, so in this frustration aggression theory, it states that aggression is caused by frustration when someone is prevented from reaching their important goal or satisfying one of their important needs, they become frustrated. So this frustration can then turn into aggression when the right trigger is present. For example, if you failed in your final exam, you will be definitely become frustrated. But what if someone you barely know told you you are such a loser not to pass the exam? So in this case, your stored frustration will surely turn into aggression. So note that frustration, aggression, theory does not provide explanation to all types of aggression, but it rather focuses on the aggression those result from not being able to reach your goals. So another example of this frustration aggression theory, okay, let's suppose that you face a certain problem in your work, and as a result you got very frustrated. Okay, now in such a case, you might find yourself becoming more aggressive towards other drivers in the street while you are in your way home. Okay, in such a case, suppressed frustration turned into aggression as soon as you got subjected to the stress of driving. So also, the frustration-aggression theory argues that social movements occur when frustration leads to collective, often aggressive behavior. Frustration has a variety of sources and can take into forms. So what are these sources? First, it can be absolute, okay, which happen when people do not have enough to survive. And the second one is it can be relative. Okay, can be relative, which happens when people have enough to survive but less than those around them. So that is the two sources of frustration. One is the absolute and the second one is the relative. So another one is the inferiority complex. Okay, when we say inferiority complex, this or inferiority complex and the Alfred Adler's theory. Okay, according to Alfred Adler, who was the first one to coin the term inferiority complex, every child experiences the feeling of inferiority as the result of being surrounded by stronger and more capable adult. Okay. As a child grows, he becomes obsessed by his original feelings of inferiority he experienced earlier, and so he strives for power recognition. So according to Adler, every child feels inferior, but not everyone develops an inferiority complex, which only affect those who failed to compensate correctly. So when we say inferiority complex, an inferiority complex is a lack of self-worth, a doubt and uncertainty about oneself, and feelings of not measuring up to standards. It is often subconscious, and it is thought to drive ineffective individuals overcompensate, resulting either in a spectacular achievement or extremely asocial behavior. In modern literature, the preferred terminology is lack of covert self-esteem. Okay. So for many scholars, or for many, it is developed through combination of genetic personality characteristic and personal experiences. So in the classical Adlerian psychology, it makes a distinction between the primary and secondary inferiority feelings. What is this primary and secondary inferiority feelings? When we say primary inferiority feeling, is said to be rooted in the young child's original experience of weakness, helplessness, and dependency. Okay, but it can be intensified by comparison to siblings, romantic partners, and adults. So the other one is the secondary inferiority feeling. It relates to an adult's experience of being unable to reach a subconscious reassuring fictional final goal of subjective security and success to compensate for the inferiority feeling. Okay? The perceived distance from that reassuring goal would lead to a negative or depressed feeling that could then prompt the recall of the original inferiority feeling. Okay. So an inferiority complex occurs when the feeling of inferiority are intensified in the individuals through discouragement or failure. Okay. Those who are weak at risk for developing a complex include people who show signs of low self-esteem, low self-worth, and have low socioeconomic status and have a history of depression symptoms. Okay. Another one is the delinquent subculture theory. So Walter Miller published an article in a journal called The Lower Class Culture as a Generating Milieu of Gang Delinquency. Okay. In this article, Walter Miller displayed the lower class form or the lower class focal concerns. Okay, what are these lower class focal concerns? Okay, we have the trouble, toughness, smartness, excitement, faith, and autonomy. Okay, so when we say trouble, okay, it is Miller states about the lower class communities evaluated by how much a person creates it. Okay. Generating trouble, as we all know, is pretty much breaking the law. Okay, such as fighting. Another one is the toughness. Okay. So in the toughness can explain by itself. It is basically how our subject would want to increase their physical and spiritual strength so that they want not be labeled as weak. Another one is the smartness. Okay, and in the street world, it is called the, or in this world, the smartness is what we call the street smart. Okay, what the subject would want is to to make money and survive on the street without consequences. The most important in this course is how to outsmart the authorities or law or the law enforcement agencies. And excitement is the next to the lower class focal concern. It explains how our subject needs to find an activity that is out of the norm from these day-to-day activities. So these activities could be ranged anywhere from fighting to sexual adventure. Another one is the faith, which depicts that people belonging to the lower class believe that their lives are controlled by a great spiritual force. And the last one is the autonomy. It pertains to our subject being independent, which is actually a requirement and usually leads to gang involvement. So this is the delinquent subculture by Walter Miller. Another one is the rational choice theory. In the rational choice theory, it is originated during the 18th century with the work of Cesare Beccaria. Okay. The rational choice theory and its assumption about human behavior have been integrated into numerous criminological theories and the criminal justice intervention. Okay. Since then, the theory has been expanded upon and extended to include other perspectives such as deterrence, situational crime prevention. In the rational choice theory, it purports that a person will commit a crime after determining if the pain or punishment is worth the pleasure or reward of the act. Okay. This theory comes from the classical and neoclassical school. And this and rational choice theory insists that crime is calculated and deliberate, and this theory better explains the instrumental crimes rather than the expressive crime. When we say instrumental crimes, it involves the planning and weighing the risk with rational mind. Example is tax evasion, traffic violation, drinking and driving, and corporate crimes. And the expressive crimes, these are crimes involving emotion and lack of rational thinking without being concerned of future consequences. Okay. So in criminology, rational choice adopts a utilitarian belief that is, man is a reasoning actors who weighs the means and ends, cause and benefits, and makes a rational choice. Okay. People is generally act in their self interest and make decision to commit crime after weighing the potential risk, including getting caught and punished, against the rewards. So we say that rational choice theory is an economic principle that states that individuals always make prudent and logical decision. Okay. Another one is the choice theory. The choice theory posits behaviors we choose are central to our existence. Our behavior choices are driven by five genetically driven needs, the survival needs, and the belonging, freedom, and fun power. Okay. The choice theory is a theory. Okay. It is the belief of individuals choose to commit a crime. Okay. Looking at the opportunities before them, weighing the benefit versus the punishment, and detecting whether to proceed or not. And the term choice theory is the work of William Glasser, and the behavior, okay, as I have said earlier, that there that behavior is driven by behavior choices is driven by five genetically driven needs: survival, love, belonging, and freedom, fun, and power. When we say survival needs, it includes the food, clothing, shelter, personal safety, security, and sex, saving children. And the four fundamental psychological needs is belonging or connecting or love, the power, significance, and or competence, the freedom or autonomy, and the fun learning. Okay. So next theory is the brief or the neutralization theory. This theory was first introduced by Gresham Sykes and David Matza. Okay. And Sykes and Matza got together and first theorized about neutralization during their time working on the what we call the differential association by Edwin Sutherland in 1960. So while working on juvenile delinquency, Sykes and Matza taught the same ideas that could be used. Okay. Neutralization theory is the idea that people who violate the law learn to neutralize the orthodox attitude and values of society, allowing them to drift between outlaw and orthodox behavior. So also Matza and Sykes believe that people have a set of justification they are used to explain and to justify their criminal behavior. So they realize that delinquents must neutralize contemporary social values if they want to be free to commit their crimes. Okay, they do this by learning the techniques that offset the moral predicaments introduced with criminal behavior. Okay, they were able to create these methods from the four or five observation. Okay, so when we say drift, it is the motion in and out of delinquency, moving from orthodox to criminal behavior. So what are the techniques of neutralization according to Sykes and David Matza? One is the denial of responsibility. When we say denial of responsibility, is many delinquents try to argue that their illegal actions are not their fault. Okay? Maybe they have a rough childhood, they were framed, or that it was an accident. Second is the denial of injury. Okay? Delinquents try to neutralize their behavior by downplaying the injuries inflicted on the victim. Okay, next one is denial of victim. Okay, many delinquents try to downplay their crimes by insisting that their victim had it coming. Most common crimes that this is used under is rape. Okay, so next one is the condemnation of condemners. Okay, when we say condemnation of condemners, many criminals see the world as a dog eat dog place, because many judges and policemen are all on the take, and many parents show favoritism between children or vent their frustration on those children. They feel these people have no room to point any fingers at them. And the last one is the appeal to higher loyalties. A young delinquent often feel the strain of who to place their loyalties to. So this is the drift or the neutralization theory. So next one is the labeling theory. When we say labeling theory, once it became known that a person has engaged in a delinquent behavior, said person is segregated from the society or a label such as thief, drug addict, or criminal. Okay. So labeling a jury serve as a process of segregation that creates outsiders or outcasts from society who beg into associate with the others who have also been cast out. Okay, this theory suggests that people are given labels based on how others view their tendencies or behavior. And one who is considered as the grandfather of this theory is Frank Tatenbaum. Okay. His Crime and Community in 1930 describing the social interaction involved in crime. And it is considered as a pivotal foundation of modern criminology. And he introduced the idea of tagging. Another one is Howard Soulbecker. Soulbecker grouped behavior into four categories. One is falsely accused. Number two is conforming. Number three is pure deviant. And number four is secret deviance. So when we say falsely accused, it represents those individuals who have engaged in obedient behavior but have been perceived as deviant. Therefore, they would be falsely labeled as deviant. Okay, next is the conforming. It represents those individuals who have engaged in obedient behavior that has been viewed as obedient behavior and not been perceived as deviant. Okay, pure deviant, it represents those individuals who have engaged in rule breaking or deviant behavior that has been recognized in as such, so therefore they would labeled as deviant by society. And the secret deviance, it represents those individuals that have engaged in rule breaking or deviant behavior but have not been perceived as deviant by society, and therefore they have not been labeled. Okay, so labeling theory is closely related to social construction and symbolic interaction analysis. Okay. So labeling theory was developed by sociologists during the 1960s. Okay. So also labeling theory is the theory of how the self-identity and behavior of individuals may be determined, influenced by the term used to describe or classify them. It is associated with the concept of self-fulfilling prophecy and stereotyping. So there are two distinctions of labeling, the hard labeling and the soft labeling. So when we say hard labeling, okay, it is believed that the mental illness does not exist. Okay, so people believe in this hard labeling, believe that mental illness that does not exist. It is merely deviance from the norms of society that people attribute to mental illness. Okay, so does mental illness are socially constructed illness and psychotic disorder do not exist. So while people who believe in self-labeling believe that mental illness do, in fact, it exists. Okay? Unlike the supporters of the hard labeling, and the self-labeling supporters believe that mental illness are not socially constructed but are objective problems. Okay? So people in power decide what acts are crimes. And the act of labeling someone is a criminal is what makes him criminal. Okay. So once a person is labeled a criminal, society takes away his opportunities, which may ultimately lead to more criminal behavior. Okay. So those who follow the labeling theory of criminology ascribe to the fact that an individual will become what he is labeled or what he is expect him to become. The danger comes from calling a crime and a criminal, okay? The way became known as labeling theories or social reaction theories. Okay, so in labeling theory, it holds that deviance is not inherent to an act, but instead focuses on the tendency of majorities to negatively label minorities or those seen as deviant from standard cultural norm. So this theory was prominent during 1960s and 1970s, and it was modified. And some modified versions of this theory have developed and are still currently popular. Okay, so that's all, and thank you.